Here we have an 1850 John Deere drill, a 30-foot drill. We got six towers on here, and that's basically six delivery points on here. We got a flex coil 1720 cart ahead of it, which flex coil made John Deere, so it's basically a John Deere cart. It's a double compartment tank. It's got a stirrator control in the bottom of the tank. We used it this year. We incorporated all of our fertilizer. It's the first time in our farm's history that we did not have any fertilizer custom applied. We applied all of our fertilizer no-till this way on all of our last year's bean and soybean stubbles. So this year, also then, we no-tilled all of our corn for the first time in our farm's history. So this allowed us to place our fertilizer just exactly where we wanted it. We weren't on anybody else's schedule. We did it the right way and did it more efficiently because we did it ourselves, and in turn we provided a real nice seed bed for our 12-row planter to come and seed the corn behind us. The drill, the disc does run at 2 degrees at an angle and 2 degrees at a camber, so it does just a tish of tillage in the bean stubble. That's the process that opens up the furrow to place the fertilizer. The heaviest rate of fertilizer we applied with it was about 475 pounds an acre. And the learning curve there was air pressure that we needed for the tank to push that fertilizer through all the towers to get to each, to all the manifolds. So like I said, this drill has six towers, which is a little more than normal, which is a huge plus for applying that much fertilizer. So we found out right away when we first started on the first field, we weren't using enough air pressure. We plugged it up and had to unhook some hoses and this and that and clean some things. And now we found out that we need to run 5,000 pounds plus air pressure on the drill for fertilizer. And slowed down, you know, we slowed down. We were probably running closer to less than 5 miles an hour to provide the, so we didn't push it too hard. And then after we did that, we eliminated all our troubles. We do have a per tower meter on here, or a run monitor. So we got a monitor in the cab that tells us if any hoses are plugged or something. So, and then when we planted cover crop later, we went, you know, started planting the orchard grasses and the alfalfas and festolium and things like that. Well, then you have to be real careful. We had to lower our air pressure down to about 2,500 pounds, 2,800 pounds, so we don't blow that seed out of the furrow. You know, so then we're thinking completely the opposite direction, you know, to limit the amount of air pressure, but yet just be just enough to feed the whole drill rights. The seed monitor in the bottom is about 2 feet wide. The calibration on it is real good. It's a real positive calibration. It's got its own stirrator in there, so for grass seed and cover crops and things of that nature, it's real accurate and works real good. And the volume, you know, you can put quite a bit of seed or fertilizer in it and cover quite a bit of ground, you know. And this is a 30-foot drill. It's like a 1997 model. We bought it from a neighbor. He no-tills everything too, and he had the star closing wheels and stuff in the back for wetter, heavier type of ground. It provides a better closer system for closing the furrow up afterwards. And so it already had some no-till experience, so it was already kind of set up for us that way. Like I said, the drill, the air cart and the tractor all came from three different places, so they weren't married to each other. That was the learning curve on our problem, on our part. That was the problem, but we dealt with that and made it work, and it works fantastic now. That thing is for fertilizer and for the cover crop seed. It was right to the pound accurate, you know. We calibrated to the tenth of a pound when we do it in the garage. There's a real good calibration system on these, and it worked real good. And the newer the drill you would buy, they're even better yet. They're pretty accurate versus a box drill. So we just had to learn and adapt to the options it already had. We weren't even aware of all of them, or we didn't. There was no real science on what air pressure to use and different things like that. That was probably our biggest learning curve. But we kept pretty good details and got it every time we calibrated it for different rations of fertilizer. Density and everything else makes a big difference on the fertilizer density and the seed density you use through it. And we used a different fine roller for the grass seed and alfalfa seed versus a coarse roller for alfalfa and soybeans and things of that nature. So there are different rollers and different options that you would use with it. Maintenance, it's been pretty good. We last year our farm, we no-tilled about 650 acres, all with the county NRCS drill. This year we're going to go probably double that. We'll probably be at 1,200 with this drill. You know, so it don't take long to pay for one yourself either. This is quite a bit more accurate, and it's here, it's handy, you know, and it's already all set up for how you want to do it. And some of this machinery, you know, we just paid in the low 20,000s for it. It's for machinery these days. It was relatively cheap, and still the same principle as the new John Deere no-till drills, you know, really. So we're pretty happy with it. It sure changed the way that we were applying fertilizer and seeding our cover crops and our forages. The cart is just a big box drill. It's just a gravity flow, a 2 foot metering roll on the bottom. We calibrate that on the farm. It's at a crank system on the side and it tells you how many cranks to crank it. There's a calibration. Most of the drills have an opening. You'll open it so far for the calibration. This is always set at the same opening, which is nice. You just change the speed of the roller. That's where the accuracy of these drills is a whole lot better. From there, there's 6 air tubes that come underneath that 2 foot roller and disperse that seed from the cart back to the drill and disperse it to the 6 towers. And then each tower, I think, has 8 hoses on it that disperses it to each individual disc. And it's a tried and true program that John Deere's had for 25 years. You know, Case IH, John Deere, and Borg, all the companies, they're all kind of the same principle, and they're pretty accurate. You know, I mean, our 12 row planter is the same way. That's air and metering involved in the same type of planter. We had to put another valve on this tractor. We need to run about 1,250 pounds of down pressure on these discs. And when we're going in the field, seeding alfalfa or putting on fertilizer, whatever, these back wheels are off the ground. They're always off the ground. That was a little bit of a learning curve too, because this tractor barely had enough hydraulic capacity, especially when we're doing fertilizer, running the fan at 5,000 pounds RPM for the fertilizer delivery, plus we needed 1,250 pounds for the down pressure on the drill. So it kind of maxed out the hydraulic capacity of this older tractor, but through some modifications, we made that work too. So this tractor's a 91 model, and it's set up now to handle a drill of this size just fine too. So the myth that you need a new tractor with new style hydraulics to run this isn't true either. We're doing it with an old tractor that's 30 years old. This is the gauge wheel. This is the cutting disc. And this is the furrow tube there. And this is the closing wheel, and this is the closing wheel from two different angles. This big disc and this whole setup runs at 2 degrees one direction and 2 degrees the other direction, which makes a seed furrow. So this green apparatus is basically just the furrow opener in the drill that places the seed at the perfect depth and closes that furrow back up and provides the best seed to soil contact that you can get with everything that's added on here. And this is a no-till unit. This will seed into basically anything. This will seed into tilled ground, but this drill was basically designed with the down pressure and the heavy dutiness and the depth control of it to be a no-till drill. And that's what we're using it for. This is a 30-foot drill on 7.5-inch spacing. It requires constant down pressure. We run the drill at 1,250 pounds of down pressure because some of the ground is hard. These discs have to cut through all the corn stalks and all the stubble that you'd be no-tilling into. In the tractor, we went with a four-wheel drive tractor because this was gonna be the first piece of equipment in the field in the spring. We knew we needed the traction. We did not want to be spinning or doing anything ahead of the drill that was gonna affect the seed bed behind the tractor. So the four-wheel drive tractor, that's why we went an older one with good tires and stuff on it. It was by far the best choice for the drill because it does take quite a little bit of power to pull it. There's two compartments inside this tank. It's a 60-40 split, so there's a little bigger tank in the back than in the front. When we put on fertilizer with it, we use both compartments and we just calibrated the drill that way. It is set up so that you could put fertilizer in the bigger tank and seed in the front tank. And split and feed different. You could seed on 15-inch spacing and put fertilizer on 15-inch spacing if you wanted to. This is the calibration crank, and these are the setting gearboxes. They do have a numbered setting on here, and there's the air tube system on here. It starts with the fan. This is what provides the air pressure here. It blows the air underneath through all them tubes, which feeds the seed all the way to each individual disc opener. So what we do, there's a crank and everything underneath there that drops that whole seed assembly for calibration. We ended up actually cranked it 25.5 times for 1 acre's worth of seeding. And we weigh that on a scale in the garage. And we weigh it down to a tenth of a pound. And the calibration on it has been fantastic. On this drill, the seed meter is that big. And it has a stirrator on top that with little picks on it that just go all the time. So that's what makes it so good for brome grass and all the different types of ryegrass and this and that tend to bridge up. Even though this was an older drill, it was by far and above what we had before, and it's really been good. We rented one, had a 15-foot. And when you double the size of what you're doing and actually increase the accuracy in the seed holding capacity in the tank, it made life a lot easier and faster. Everything we do out on the farm here, we're up against Mother Nature all the time. You know, we're always just waiting for the conditions to be right, and the window seems to be getting smaller. We're with a little bigger equipment and a little more efficient equipment, we don't find ourselves working through the night so much. this drill floats. What's their six tires in the back, there's six tires in the front. And then when you put all the drill down on the ground, all them gauge wheels across on the units, they're holding the drill up too. So once this thing is in action going, the drill itself floats really well. There's so many depth wheels on the ground, you know, that are rolling along. The tractor, the horsepower and the traction are fine. We did max out the hydraulic capacity that we needed with it. It was nice to have a tractor with that size of tire, the new tires on it. Just like I said before, if you don't ever spin the pull tractor, you'll never mess up the seed bed in front of the drill. And that's huge, because we've had that issue before. You can't mess up anything with the drill or the cart that needs to be ahead of the drill. But with no-till, you're always entering the ground, maybe a little on the wetter side and this and that, because you're covered with so much material. And then with this tractor setup, that was never an issue this year. It worked really good. The tractor is a 1991 model 9250. It's a power shift tractor, four-wheel drive. It has GPS in it. It's an integrated GPS, which is, with the drill or anything else, accuracy, not overlapping or skipping, is very important. So it came with a GPS system in it. We have the full run monitor for the drill that tells me if any hoses are plugged or anything on the back of the drill, that's very important too. Because, you know, you don't want to be going out there and skipping or having any issues. You want every coulter on that drill to be seeding or putting fertilizer down. The top orange monitor, that's a blockage monitor, they call it, for the drill, and that tells me if there's any rows on the drill that are plugged with seed or fertilizer. So that way we don't end up with a row that's not seeding or fertilizing. The next one down, the flex coil monitor, is the air cart monitor. That's the seed tank monitor. That tells us the fan speed, the ground speed, the amount of pounds that each meter is putting out, and has the switches, the on and off switches per tank. And then the bottom monitor is the GPS monitor for the tractor, and that's what keeps the planter, the tractor, and the whole system driving straight up and down the field, so we don't have any overlaps or skips. There's a monitor here for the cart, so it tells me the air pressure, it tells me the acres I've covered, it tells me the speed I'm going, it tells me each hopper, it tells me the pounds per acre, or the pounds that I'm putting down through the tubes. Our next thing, the only enhancement we're going to make with this drill, is we're going to put load sensors in here to lift this box up off the frame, and we're going to put load sensors in here so that we know exactly if we go out to do 50 acres with a 50 acre mix, that once we get over half of it, that we know we have exactly half the amount of seed left. You know, if we go out to do 50 acres and we put 50 acres of seed in here, at 25 acres, we want to make sure that we exactly are not seeding too heavy or too light, because that's the one problem with cover crops and alfalfa and stuff. You typically buy it in a blended mix, and you can't get you can't go get two more bags to finish up in the next hour or so. Accuracy for calibration on cover crops and stuff like that is very important for that, because the seed you get is the seed you got, and you have to make it work. You don't want to be seeding too light or too heavy. We buy our seed from a seed company in Perm, and we've been seeding Timothy orchard grass, Festolium, alfalfa, some reed canary. We put some perennial rye in there. You know, it's try and put in, I don't know, maybe what the heck the last thing we did, about 8 or 10 mix, you know, 8 or 10 species mix, because on any given day, on any given acre, you want one of those things to be growing all the time. And that's kind of how we learned it, but we try and keep it within reason so that the seed is kind of all the same size, the same weight, and this and that, so that the drill works better. Because at the end of the day, it's only as good as how you got it planted. You know, so and try and plant things that are relatively consistent for seeding depth of what they should be planted, the depth they should be planted at. It's hard to get these drills to plant anything very consistent at less than an inch. We planted teff grass, and that stuff, they recommend that the seeding depth is at like an eighth of an inch. Well, that's virtually impossible with any drill. Yeah. And teff is so hard anyway, because I'm getting off on a tangent here, but teff grass grows root underground long before it comes out of the ground. So then you always feel like, well, I didn't do a very good job here. And then all of a sudden, bang, it shoots out of the ground. And then the second crop is, you barely get it bailed fast enough before it shoots out, you know, regrows. Just, it's got such an incentive root system on it. It's crazy, but it's an Ethiopian grass. We had good luck with that too. We planted that as a complement or a cover crop with alfalfa, and man, it had a heck of a yield. We broadcast the teff and mixed it with the fertilizer and broadcast that, and then we seeded the alfalfa back behind it with the drill. But I think the teff would have been fine with the alfalfa seed in the same furrow. I think that's what we'll do next time. That would have been better. because alfalfa is only supposed to be about a quarter inch deep too, and it seems to be just fine at 3/4 of an inch to inch deep too. That's where we planted it this year, and that stuff was out of the ground so fast. I mean, anything you plant, the main thing you have to have is seed to soil contact for that, you know, because around this area you can go for a couple weeks at a time, and if you've broadcast some seed, you're not going to have nothing going on until you get moisture, and then you're going to lose some of your seed, by you know, your vitality of the seed. It doesn't have that much energy to not grow, you know, for that long. You know, you're going to lose some of your vigor. We had good snow cover. We went into a nice spring, and Mother Nature did cooperate. She was terrible through calving, but she was pretty good through planting. And then we were getting small, decent, timely rains. You know, like last night, we got a half inch. We got 3/10, you know, 7/10. We've had a good growing season here. We're right on pace with 2018's crop right now, and we're way farther ahead than we were on the 2019 crop. So, pretty happy about that. It'll seed all of our cover crops, and we also have 75 acres of pasture to interseed here. Yeah. And we're going to seed that in a rotation as the cows graze it. So right now I got 35 acres that's ready to seed that we just ran the cows off of the other day. Now this drill is going to do everything that we can possibly have it do. It's going to apply our fertilizer and plant our grain and all of our forages and plant our cover crops, you know, other than what the interseeder does in standing corn. So yeah, it was a good fit for us. And it's nice to have your own too, because when you figure out all the quirks and the little details of it and the calibration of it, you know, then you know it's ready to go for you the next time.